to the November 16th Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting. The first order of business this evening is to... And we didn't act on it last time.
On the second paragraph containing the number 2, third line down, there's a typo toward the end of the line, "let alone be enforceable by the town." In the paragraph following, it begins, "the proposed rating for the house and yard should be developed to channel runoff from the roof and paving." I'm not sure what that should read. It doesn't make sense to me now, but grading. Thank you, Tom.
Did you get that?
Grading.
Grading.
And on page 3, third paragraph down, I was hoping to clarify that paragraph a little bit, and I could only come up with a little bit. Starting from the beginning, Ms. Lardner noted the issue of the 250-foot setbacks, first from the Great Pond critical wetland. Then I would propose to read, "which cannot be reduced, comma," and then have it read as written. Those were my only comments.
Any other comments, corrections? Do I hear a motion? Tom?
I move that the minutes of the 21 September meeting 1993 be approved as amended.
As amended. Thank you. It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. They're accepted as amended. October 19th. Meeting minutes. Any discussion, any comment, any corrections?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Judy.
Page 3.
Mm-hmm.
The last large paragraph on the page.
Last large paragraph, okay.
Yes, in the third line, a sentence begins, "the inn then decided they would like a different internal layout for the," I believe it should read, "shed" instead of "door." My only comment.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Anybody else? I just say on the first page, first paragraph under Wild Rose subdivision, middle page, Mr. Parker, Mr. Russell excuse themselves because of, scratch the word possible, just leave the word perceived, conflicts of interest or bias. Page 3. Two-thirds of the way down the page, the paragraph starting, "Mr. Moore said that it was before the board." Last sentence that reads, "said this proposed deletion would do nothing more than leave the site." Not leaving, but leave the site.
Right here.
That's all I had. Do I hear a motion?
Propose we accept the minutes as amended.
It's been moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's unanimous. They're accepted as amended. Thank you. Go down through the correspondence. First, a letter from Mike Hill. In reference to the Sprague lawsuit, with a copy of the order, I would like to bring up, and I guess I'll mention in combination with this a memo, because it's on the same topic, from Mike McGovern to the planning board that was on the podium tonight, dated the 10th. Reading of the record, at a meeting of the town council on November 8th, 1993, has voted 5-1 not to appeal the recent court decision remanding to the planning board the Ramshead subdivision. As most of the discussion relating to the decision occurred in executive session, I am not able to provide the council's rationale for the decision. Town Council Ordinance Committee will be reviewing the ordinance language to ensure that the original intent of the language can be enforced. We would appreciate any suggestions from the board may have. At the end of this, under other business, I'd like to come back to that topic, just a brief discussion with the board dealing with the intent of that portion of the ordinance in a possible proceeding at this point. Next, a letter from Peter Malia in reference to Beals Ice Cream site plan. Not really requesting, simply saying that appreciate not having to appear before the November Planning Board meeting and delaying our presentation until December. I would also like to add just a brief discussion on that item for other business. Next, the October edition of Environment and Development Newsletter, also the November issue of the same publication. Next, a letter from Chris Nagel referencing the Wild Rose subdivision. If you read through that, you understand that evidently it was transferred to Hilda Cushing Dudley. I don't know if it is in that name. I have a question of the planner in reference to this. Is the new owner looking for the town to do something that other than would normally be taken care of by normal course of law? In other words, if this plan were not recorded within 90 days, that issue would die, would it not? As far as the easement?
The easement's already been conveyed.
It has been?
Yes.
Okay.
And there was a recording prior to the most recent approval of the board, so even if the most recently approved plan wasn't recorded, there's still going to be one on the books.
Okay. Clears up my question. I'd like to also, because in our workshop sessions we're dealing with the town center zone, a article that you had photocopied prior when we were dealing with road standards, I think was interesting. Maybe recopy this for our next workshop. You can have that copy if you will. Dealing with designing, I think, pedestrian-friendly commercial streets, if that's possible. Any other correspondence for the board? Okay. We'll go on to old business. First order of old business, Rams Head Subdivision, remand from Superior Court to reconsider the request of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review of Rams Head, a four-lot subdivision located off Charles E. Jordan Road, Section 16-2-3. In proceeding back with this remand, I think I'd like to ask if there's a representative who would like to speak for the Rams Head application. I guess to only go over any new issues that are not mentioned in what was submitted to us. In other words, I don't think we need to go over any changes, and if there are no changes, we simply state so.
Very thick file on this project, of course.
My name is Rick Cheney. I'm a lawyer with Drummond Woodson Plimpton McMahon in Portland. I represent Mr. Sprague. Mr. Sprague is here tonight along with Brad here from Land Use Consultants, and we're prepared to answer any questions. Those of you who are on the board, of course, know that this project started its way through your process in April of last year and culminating in a meeting a year ago tonight, November meeting of 1992, at which the board denied the application for approval based on the dead-end road issue. At that meeting, there were three issues identified as being outstanding: the dead-end road problem, the performance guarantee, and your open space requirement. The dead-end road standard, of course, has been resolved as a result of the Superior Court's decision, and as Chairman Etzel read tonight, the council voted not to appeal that decision. So the decision stands, and it plainly and simply says that the board is to consider only the roads within the subdivision and those that are part of the subdivision in calculating the distance for your dead-end road standard. And when you exclude the public roads, the distance is well below your standard for compliance. As to the performance guarantee, Mr. Hare has met with Mr. Moran, and there is no disagreement as to the items that make up the performance guarantee, and Mr. Sprague is prepared to post whatever is required to meet that requirement. And finally, the open space requirement, there was a fair amount of discussion at last November's meeting about some fine-tuning of the plan to make our note, which was put on there to comply with your requirements for open space, clearer and make it clear as to what portion of the project it applied to. And we've made necessary changes to the plan, which we believe address all the concerns raised, which were primarily raised by Chairman Etzel and Ms. Lardner. So with those three issues being the only issues addressed as being outstanding at last November's meeting, and with all of them having been satisfied in our opinion, we're here tonight to ask for final approval for the application as presented with the waivers and the wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver. And again, I'm here as well as Brad and Mr. Sprague, if you wish to answer any questions.
Thank you, Rick. How we proceed now is up to the board. Sometimes it's difficult when you come back to an application that's a year old, and then we, as board members, don't tend to keep all of that information other than what was resubmitted to us. Trying to jog our memory where we left off, what prompted the vote, et cetera, questions that were still in the minds of board members. I have additional questions to ask of the applicant, but I'd like to get some type of consensus from the board. Are there more questions the board members have to ask of the applicant? Tom?
No, I don't have any substantive questions. I think it's more of a code enforcement office question in terms of interpreting the shoreline setback, and it doesn't affect any of the existing proposed building envelopes. The only issue is whether the top of the bank is going to be used consistently for the shoreline setback, or in fact in ledgy areas, whether they're using the slope of the ledge, which it appears they're doing in the areas that are already built up. Okay. So, but in reviewing the plans, I didn't see a significant impact on the buildability of what they're proposing to do. Other than that, I'd like to move ahead as quickly as possible.
Okay, sure. Judy?
Okay. I have some comments, but I'd wait to see if anyone else does.
Okay. Stephen?
I really have none.
Okay. Robert, anything? Peter?
No.
Mark? Okay. I do have a few questions, and they deal primarily with, I think it's lot 3, and I hate to get the whole map out here, but and so I'll try to do most of it from memory, and I think is it Bruce? No, it's not Bruce. Brad? It's been a year. If you can, just to refresh my memory, on lot number 3, I remember very well the main house being where it is, and then the outline of just house. Is that proposed new construction, or is there an existing structure there now?
All those shown on the plans are existing structures.
Okay.
There are two houses there.
Two major houses, right. There on lot 3 now.
The main house and the annex house.
Okay. It shows the water line coming onto the subdivision site and going from a pump house to a shutoff, and then takes a zigzag around a proposed location for a replacement septic system. And I may have asked this question when I was here before, but I simply don't remember. The difference in elevation between, that's an existing water line now, is that correct?
Correct.
All right. And the elevation of the proposed septic line, where it intersects with that, with the water line?
Where it intersects,
yeah,
with the water line?
Right.
I don't think you've asked that question before. What is the question? The difference in elevation?
The question is, what's the difference in elevations between the two?
We do not know. It's existing water line, it's been in place for years.
Right.
Constructing the septic system.
We're
talking about Lot 3?
Yes, yeah. Where's the existing septic system there now?
It's not.
On Lot 3?
There are no.
Is it overboard discharge?
It's overboard discharge.
Okay. Maybe that, is that what the SMH stands for? Remember there's a beam?
Yeah.
What's that stand for?
Sewer manhole.
Sewer manhole. I looked all over the place that last night.
Or sanitary manhole.
Okay. So basically the replacement system there, is that going to be required that that's replaced, the overboard discharge now?
Yes.
Due to state law?
Yeah. We're subdividing, you know, we're creating a subdivision.
Right.
So, I mean, we're technically able to continue our overboard discharge, mm-hmm. but, you know, we choose not to just because it just makes a better property with the
yeah.
septic.
What's the size of the water main there where it intersects? Do you know the
Got the size of the water main, water line coming through there? What's that? Well, I know, but, you know, Gunther, who's the manager out there, believes it's 1.5 inches.
Mm-hmm. I get right to the question. Is there any state plumbing code dealing with water lines intersecting sewer lines?
I'd have to look at the plan. I guess I'm a little
confused on the line of questioning.
Well, from the main house, it goes out to sewer manhole, and then it's looking at a forced main or forced sewer line back to the replacement system. That intersects with the water line, over the water line.
He's talking about the, probably that.
The manhole that's on the corner.
Why don't you?
You want to come and take a look at this?
Yeah, I want to take a look exactly
where. Sure. Do you know where it's located? Right here. See where the water line comes in. Come back here in the replacement system, and I take that's a forced main.
Right.
So it's going to be under pressure to get back to this?
Yes.
Okay.
Now where's the water line here?
Right here.
Okay.
The water line.
Yeah.
And the reason I'm asking, you know, the difference in elevation from the two, typically is not a problem unless you've got a fairly equal pressure. And if you've got a forced main here and water pressure here, poses a problem, but my question was, say plumbing code.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to have to, you know, everything will be constructed, you know, according to state standards, so I can't tell you what the water main
right
now.
My question is why design something that's not to a state standard?
Well, we're going to get out there, we're going to construct the septic system. Obviously, if there's a problem, we're going to be in the process with Ernie McVain. Those are, you know, it's an old water line. We're going to be, you know, examining that. We're going to be examining the exact location. You know, I'd imagine that.
Okay. Are you planning to replace it with a 1-inch water main?
We're not planning on replacing it right now, you know, with anything. We're going to be drilling wells for each of the individual lots. And lot number 3 is going to continue to get its water where it's always got its water from. And that is by the greenhouse on the original farm.
I guess that's not real clear to me. Nor is it clear on lot 2. It doesn't appear that it's coming from a well. It appears it's coming from the water main itself.
No.
There are only two issues that I have dealing with that. Dealing with sewer code with the bisecting lines, both under pressure. Number 2, the requirement for sprinkling systems in the houses. And I think the plan shows that it's a 1-inch water line coming in, whether that can handle that requirement.
You know, once again, you know, we've met with the fire chief. He's established what he needs for water line. If it's a 1-inch or it's a 1.5-inch, if he said it's a 1-inch, it's going to be a 1-inch. I guess I'm still very confused by the water issue. I mean, lot 1 has its own well, lot 2 is going to have its own well. Lot 3 is going to be the only one that, and is currently the only one using water off that line. If it's going to be a problem when we're in construction, you know, obviously, you know, Ernie McVane is going to make us keep the distance if it's a bad pipe or a pipe has to be moved. We're going to be in compliance with state standards. Where those state standards apply right now, we could not tell you precisely. And we're not going to go up there and, you know, tear up the whole water line to determine, you know, where it is exactly underneath the lawn right now. All I can tell you is it's going to be constructed properly, or we undoubtedly won't get a building permit.
That's nice to know, but usually that's shown on the plan.
What's that?
I say that's nice to know, but that's usually shown on the plan.
Well, this is an unusual situation, I guess, to me, is when we're dealing with an old structure.
Mr. Stetser, if I may, if I understand your questions, are you concerned about the proximity of the current water line with the current septic system and whether there are...
No, the proposed septic system, they said that they're going to change it to use this proposed...
Like any construction, obviously, when someone gets out there and builds a house, they're going to have to build that house and build the new septic system and drill the well in accordance with applicable local and state codes, which are a bit beyond the basic subdivision review that we're talking about now. Obviously, if they can't meet code, they're not going to be able to put the well here and the septic system there. But those seem to me to be issues that are going to come up in the building process when somebody seeks a permit to build their house and construct their system and drill their well, not necessarily something that's part of your consideration of this project, its overall impacts with the surrounding area. So I think, again, I think...
I disagree. I think it is a part of the review, and especially a location like this where you're on a point of land on the ocean, and there really is not much other area to put a septic system for that location. It was a pretty straightforward question as to...
I mean, the lots have been found to have adequate soils to supply, to deal with the systems. We've been found to have an adequate water supply through wells. These are issues that were already discussed.
Right.
With all due respect, a little concerned about rehashing things that have already been discussed.
It's open for this board to rehash whatever it wants to rehash.
Well, again, I mean, I think these issues have been dealt with. The plans have been looked at by the code enforcement officers. We've adequate sites, adequate soils, adequate water.
You're missing my whole point, Rick.
Well, with all due respect, I don't understand it.
It's very clear. It does not make sense to pass, to approve a site plan when it contradicts with state plumbing code.
Well, I'm not sure that...
All I'm asking you, and you should be the experts that know whether that's a conflict of state. If it's not, then just simply say so.
Ernie McVane has reviewed these and has found them to be in compliance with your code.
And the state plumbing code. They've been designed...
I mean, they've been designed in accordance, you know, so I don't know what...
We have an engineer's stamp on it, we have a site evaluator's stamp on it.
I mean, we have gone through the process of dealing with the issue you're talking about.
So you can assure me that that's within code?
I could assure you...
Thank you. That was my question. Thank you.
Yep.
Judy, do you have any comments, questions?
First, let me say I'm not really unhappy to see you folks back here or the outcome of the court case. I think it's very unfortunate the whole way it happened, but I am still very disappointed in the approach you've taken to the satisfying this town's open space standards. I'm the one who's talked about this mainly, and I feel like you've been kicking and screaming every step of the way to address that standard. I'd like to say first that you have references to the subdivision standard that are incorrect with respect to open space. The plans need to be revised. Notes 19 on sheets 2, 4, and 5, and note 17 on the recording plat, the reference should read section 16-3-1 subsection Q. I also think that if the only way you're going to try to address open space is by saying that the critical wetland zone is intended to meet that particular standard, I'd like to see on the second sheet of the recording plat either a continuation of the critical wetland zone line, or conversely, there's a note that talks about land, land on this plan is within the critical wetland zone. I'd like you to say all land, to be generous to the town. Since that's the bulk of how you're satisfying the open space requirement, and you're leaving it very open to question what land that is, I don't find that acceptable. Thirdly, I think I was the one who made an offhand remark about, you know, show some attempt to meet the standard. If you want to argue that this is scenic open space as viewed from the ocean, do it. So there's a little note, I think, trying to take that approach, but I've yet to see a justification how this project meets the standard. I've seen a lot of arguments why the standard should not apply. And as far as I'm concerned, this could be a condition of approval, but I would like to see a legitimate justification why this huge subdivision, which to me in some ways is great, how it meets the standard, how it meets the 10% setback. If you're arguing that you've got a wonderful scenic view that's that will be preserved from the ocean, I'd like to see you state that and why that meets that section of the ordinance for the record. I feel very uncomfortable if we were to act on this now with the lack of information or the, to me, the apparent attempt not to meet the ordinance except to make a reference. I think that's a terrible precedent for this town to set. I think you know that I've never pushed for public access on this. I am disappointed that there's no attention given to the Little Pond wetland area. I think that would be primed to also make some sort of statement that it was preserved for open space, and I can appreciate your argument for not wanting homeowners association for a four-lot subdivision. But I just don't know what to say other than I'm disappointed in that, and I hope that you'll at least make an argument for justifying what you're doing.
Well, I guess I guess I'm a little stunned, and this may be. I guess I'm a little stunned, but you know, then maybe this is allowing to the time that's gone by. We went over this again and again, and it seems very fresh in my mind, and I know it seems very fresh in Rick's mind because we've spent considerable amount of time last few weeks viewing all the videotapes to make sure that we were doing things properly. So, you know, we've gone over your statement. We've seen you make the statement. We've seen Mr. Edsel make his statements regarding the open space. And we openly admitted that, you know, we had to change our statement on the recording plat according to your words to satisfy your words. And we used your words. And in recognition of the undeveloped character of the land as viewed from the Atlantic Ocean, and in accordance with Section 3-1Q of the subdivision ordinance, no further development shall be permitted in the area shown on the plan as critical wetland zone. And it goes on about utility poles. Then on the recording plat here, we've placed on sheet 2, land shown on this plan. All land shown on this plan is within the critical wetland zone of Cape Elizabeth. This land also includes sand dunes. Therefore, the land is prohibited from further development. Now, albeit you may have an outdated plan where that doesn't show, but I could, you know, show you this recording plat. It's here to give to the board.
How does that read differently?
Well, I believe your statement was having to do with the land shown on the ordinance as critical wetland zone. And your comment to us was, well, we could change the definition of critical wetland zone, so why don't you spend more attention and address the critical wetland zone shown on the plan. Therefore, those lines would never move. That's how we changed it. And we had just made a statement regarding open space. We hadn't addressed the section, and we hadn't addressed the significance of the land.
So how does it read on the recording plan?
Okay. You want the in recognition statement?
Yeah.
In recognition
of
the undeveloped,
that's note 20 you're referring to.
This is note 17 on the recording plat. On the subdivision plat, there are a few more notes regarding other issues that don't show up on the recording plat. Note 17 on the recording plat is in recognition of the undeveloped character of the land as viewed from the Atlantic Ocean and in accordance with the section of the subdivision ordinance, no further development shall be permitted in the area shown on the plan as critical wetland zone. provided, however, that this restriction shall not prohibit the maintenance, repair, and replacement of necessary existing overhead electric wires, da-da-da-da-da.
Located on said...
Located on said portion of Lot 4.
Lot 4?
Right.
Okay, does it list the section of the, on your recording plan?
Yes, it does.
What's it listed as?
16.3-1Q.
Is that what it is? I'd have to have my... This says 19.
Okay.
But again,
that has to be correct.
That may be, you know, that may be our drafting machine giving a nice 9 instead of a Q. I'll have to look into that.
Yeah, that should be Q.
Mr. Hare, on my sheet 2, it does not say all land, as you just stated. It says land shown on this plan is within the critical wetland zone.
Is within the critical wetland zone?
Yes, it doesn't say all land. It's my understanding that the bulk of that lot is. I'm sorry, I feel...
We could add, you know, we could sit here and we could add in all the alls that you want. We have no problem with that. You know, it's getting to the point where, you know, land shown on this plan, you know, I'm sorry if I've assumed, but land shown on this plan, there is no other land shown on this plan except the land shown on this plan. So land shown on this plan, I just put it down.
Okay.
I'll be more than happy to put in
okay.
all land shown on this plan.
My concern is the history of how this project has, or this applicant or representatives has approached the open space issue. It has not been, you have not been forthcoming about trying to address the standard. I can pull out any number of memos from Mr. Cheney saying why this doesn't apply. I have also gone through this very carefully, and I know exactly what I stated, and I think we pretty much are agreeing on that.
Right.
I do think, and I said this over and over, that it's a very half-hearted attempt. And if this is the way you want to do it, I'll accept that. But I want to see in the record why you think that meets it. This is a very standard request. Often developers will come through, I haven't seen it in this town too much, but saying, here are your standards, you have to have adequate schools. We think you have adequate schools because we are only adding an estimated 15 children. I'd like to see a statement to that effect saying why you think this approach, viewing it from the ocean, and it does specifically talk about adequate public access in this case, and you could probably, and I'll give you words like I always seem to, why you think people in boats can go and have adequate public access or visual access. I have not seen that to date. I recognize this note, and I don't think that is something, because you're really trying to meet the intent of the ordinance, I think you're trying to get approval, and you're addressing my comments.
And I am stunned by that. I'm really stunned because of the fact that we were here going over this over and over and over again. And, you know, regarding the public access, it's not an issue. It doesn't come up in this plan. We've already discussed that.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, it was your words exactly which we put down that you said, if we did this, you'd be fine. And now we put it down, albeit a year goes by, all of a sudden it's not fine. And I don't know, I mean, I could add in all the flowery statements we want, and I'll be happy to do it, but in recognition of the undeveloped character, I could add in scenic undeveloped character, if we'd all like, of the land as viewed from the Atlantic Ocean.
Mr. You know, Hare, I'm not asking you to change that note. I'm not saying you're going to lose my vote on this. As you've said yourself, this is on the plan because I said this. It's not because this is your attempt to meet an ordinance. You've argued against the ordinance all along. That's all I'll say about it. I, as one board member, would like to see in this record why this developer thinks this meets the subdivision standard and why this board agreed with you.
Mrs. Lauder, I think I have a pretty good recollection of the history of this project. And I don't think I don't think we have to give you our opinion as to why we think we are meeting the ordinance. The fact of the matter is we had much discussion. In fact, most of the first 4.5 meetings on this project were focused primarily on discussion about whether the applicant would permit public access across this property. And we focused on this section. As you all recall, it wasn't until the 5th meeting that our attention was diverted to the dead end road issue. That issue was gone. As we came up to the November meeting, we had had much discussion with you, and we had stated for the record that we simply didn't believe it was within your authority to require us to give public access to this property. So we worked towards a negotiated provision. I think partly at your suggestion, partly at others, but we reached what we considered, in all fairness, to be a satisfactory compromise. And at the last meeting, and I'll point you to your findings of fact, in which it stated quite clearly, we have substantially addressed that provision. The applicant has substantially addressed the requirements of 16.3Q with respect to open space, although minor amendments to the subdivision plat may be required. You made, just let me finish, please. You made comments, you, primarily you and Mr. Etzel, but others, pointing to some things on the plan that could be made a little clearer, tying that note into the area shown on this plan as opposed to critical wetland generally. We spent much time reviewing that meeting, made the changes that we had understood were of concern to you. Now, I appreciate you personally may not be happy with the outcome, but the point is we, in good faith, proceeded and reached on that issue what we considered to be an acceptable, albeit not maybe acceptable to you personally or to the group, but we had reached a point where you were prepared and you signed findings of fact saying that issue has been addressed to your satisfaction, subject to the minor changes which Brad has made. Now, you seem to be saying, I want to go back and revisit the whole thing, and I want the applicant to give us an opinion why we've satisfied your standard. We've satisfied your standard because that issue was discussed, an agreement was reached, and we made some changes to the plan to address the concerns raised in November. So you have a finding that we've addressed the standard. You may not be happy with how we approached that standard, but you have to understand that this is a unique project, and you were asking us, as far as we were concerned, to consider letting the public go on to get to the beach. And we weren't prepared to do that, and we're still not prepared to do that. So we think we've met it. We've made the changes to the plan that you asked for. I appreciate your personal opinion. We are not trying to be evasive. We are simply trying to stand up for Mr. Sprague's rights in the situation. We feel in good faith we've met your standard through a negotiated arrangement, culminating in that note tied into the critical wetland.
Okay, I'd like to correct a couple of things. That proposed motion, before it was made, those findings of facts, it was proposed to read that you did not meet that section. I said substantially. At the point we made that motion, it was very clear that this project was not, or I assume was not going to pass based on the dead end standard. When I said substantially in that finding of fact, when I proposed to change that and the board agreed, my intent was that you are addressing it substantially. I did not mean to state that you have completely addressed that standard. Again, I'm not asking to reopen this. I'm not asking for you, even though I wish you would have, to put some protection for that pond wetland. I'm not asking for public access as we have all been discussing it. It does state in here that land reserved for primary scenic or passive recreation purposes shall have sufficient public access as determined by the planning board. And I can read that very broadly when you're talking about the access is visual access from the water or what have you. My major concern was I have not, and I can go find all my little notes on where I stated that I was very uncomfortable with the way you were approaching the open space public act, not public access, because I haven't supported that, the open space or scenic standard, whatever you want to call it, subsection Q. Because this is the final proposal you are giving us, the other issue has been laid to rest, I would like to see some justification. I'm not asking for any other land. I'm not asking for public access. I am disappointed with this, and the board may not agree with me, but that be that as it may, I don't think it's fair to say I'm reopening things or anything of that nature.
The justification for the record on our note and why we believe it meets your standards, if you want it, is that the applicant is committed to not develop an area of land that is quite visible from the ocean. A lot of people sail boats down between this and Richmond Island. It's a beautiful view. The applicant has agreed not to develop the land. It has scenic value. Scenic value is recognized in many ordinances. It's certainly recognized at the DEP level and has been used in many cases to deny projects. So our justification for that is we are agreeing not to build anything other than maintenance of the existing telephone lines and utility lines within an area of the property that could otherwise, in the future, perhaps be built upon for preservation of the scenic view, you know, a small part of the main coast, if you will, that will never be developed, so that it preserves the view from the only place where it can be seen, public property, and that's the ocean. I mean, that is our justification for it, and, you know, that's it. I put that in the record tonight, obviously, and you know, that's why we feel we've met your standard. Again, I appreciate that the standard is open to discussion and interpretation, and there may be concern that in your eyes that's not sufficient justification, but that is our justification for the record.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I just want to state that I think that the discussion was reasonable and warranted concerning the 1 year that's passed. It was a key and sometimes heated discussion referencing that, and there's no reason why it shouldn't. It was not a case of rehashing anything. It was just a case of, at the time, the applicant, if my memory serves me correctly, didn't feel that they needed to address certain items dealing with that portion of the ordinance, simply because the applicant considered it to be a unique subdivision, and this board didn't feel it was any more unique than many other subdivisions, and that it simply needed to address, if they were not going to totally fulfill that portion of the ordinance, that they make mention why they weren't. Okay.
Obviously, if there were typographical errors in recitation to the section of the applicable, you know, that can be changed. That's just a
question, and it's just because I'm slow in hearing or understanding or whatever, but there's a phrase that I remember my requesting being changed, and it says, and I think it's the phrase, area shown on the plan as critical wetland zone. Is that the way it reads on the recording plat?
Area shown on the plan as critical wetland zone.
My comment was prior to that, it just referenced the critical wetland zone. My concern was if we changed that or wetlands definitions changed, that I just simply wanted that area to remain.
And we're happy with that. I mean, tying it to this plan, I think, was your point.
Okay. Any other discussion, questions, comments? Stephen?
Yeah. I may be overlooking something, but on sheet 1 of 3, it says lot 4 is 27.2 acres. Sheet 2 of 3, it says total area of lot 2 is 27.9 acres. Am I missing something?
Yeah, I was waiting for how long that would take for somebody to find. We've corrected that, and it's 27.2 acres. Right. And it's right on the recording plat. It's 27.2.
Which is the proper acre?
27.2.
Is that a C? Okay, Tom?
Brad, I think just for the public record, and to be sure that there's no confusion when you go for building permits, what I was referring to earlier, if you were to look at, if you would look at sheet 2 of 8, do you have that available?
No.
I'll describe it then. You indicate 150-foot setback from mean high water, and then a 250-foot wide shoreline from mean high water. There's a line or a graphic indicator that is slightly above elevation 5, and then it dives into the rock shore. And as the rock shore continues, you have top of ledge labeled. And in some places in our ordinance, it refers to measuring the shoreline setback from the top of ledge or top of cliff or something to that effect. I don't have the language in front of me. I don't know if you've been out here with Ernie, but I think if you were to graphically indicate on the plan, as you have in other places, where that dimension is taken from and where it obviously ends up at the setback line, so that there's no confusion either with your understanding of where it's measured from, or if either Ernie or a future code enforcement officer were to go to the site and find another spot like the top of the bank. I haven't been out there, obviously, for more than a year, but the ledge in front of the main house is very shallow. It's essentially a shallow, beachy ledge sort of situation. It's not a steep drop-off.
No, the one in front, right in front of the main house towards the ocean is a fairly significant drop-off. It's probably, 15, 16 feet.
Did you confirm with Ernie the location of the assumption for the shoreline setback?
Well, basically what we've done is, you know, the 5.5 is based on the survey and the tie charts and everything like that. We have not gone to the point of going, you know, foot by foot with the ledge and all. We'll be happy to put that on the recording plat.
I just wouldn't want to see either the applicant or a prospective buyer surprised when they go to code enforcement officer. Something might be different than indicated on the plan. That's the extent of my comments.
Any others? Judy?
No, but I do have a proposed motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact. 1. Shaw Sprague has requested minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located at the end of Charles E. Jordan Road, which requires review under Section 16-3-1 of the Subdivision Ordinance, Section 19-3-904 of the Wetlands Regulations, and Section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. 2. The application was deemed complete in May 1992, and a public hearing was held at the June 1992 Planning Board meeting. 3. A performance guarantee is necessary to assure compliance with the approved subdivision plan and in accordance with Section 16-2-4C7A. 4. The plan substantially complies with Section 16-3-1 of the Subdivision Ordinance, Section 19-3-9-04 of the Wetlands Regulations, and Section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. 5. Just say minor modifications are necessary to the plans. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located off of Charles E. Jordan Road, be granted subject to the following conditions. 1. That a performance guarantee in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager, town engineer, and town attorney be submitted to the town planner. 2. That the plans be revised to correct note 19 on sheets 2, 4, and 5, and note 17 on the recording plat to correctly reference section 16-3-1Q of the subdivision ordinance. 3. That the recording plat sheet 2 be revised to indicate the entire extent of the critical wetland zone boundary, or to revise the note located under the total area of lot 2 to indicate that all of the land shown on the plan is within the critical wetland zone. 4. That the recording plats be revised to show the proper acreage and lot numbers for lot 4. 5. That the applicant submit to the town planner a written statement for the record explaining how this project meets the provisions of section 16-3-1Q of the subdivision ordinance. 6. That these conditions be met prior to recording the subdivision plan.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Further discussion?
I'd just like to point out for the board, if they disagree, that I did include something about a written statement.
Question that I have is and just looking for consensus from the board, acting on motions with considerable number of conditions. Recently, that's posed problematic for the board. And I guess I'll yield to the planner to help explain or clarify the issue of conditions being met before the recordation. And are we under a 90-day, minor subdivisions are under a 90-day recording ordinance requirement. Is there still a question in our ordinance as to from which date the 90 days is actually counted? Is that question still unanswered in our ordinance? as it stands right now.
Okay, start with the conditions?
Yes. That was kind of a long question, so.
Typically, in the past, the board has been uncomfortable, reticent about approving a plan conditionally with this number of conditions. However, as long as the conditions are very specific and clearly stated, so that there's not a lot of subjectivity in them, it shouldn't be a problem for staff to make sure that what you want it done gets done. Addressing the whole issue of the condition, I believe the intent was that prior to recording the subdivision plat, that all these conditions would be met. The ordinance states that the plat has to be recorded within 90 days. However, Mr. Edsel is correct that our ordinance currently has an ambiguity in it, where it not in the minor subdivision section, in the major subdivision section, it talks about final plan approval, and the final plan approval does not begin until the board has signed the plat. So if the board's intent in voting on this motion is to make sure that all these conditions are met within 90 days and that the plat be recorded within 90 days, you probably just want to add that on to your motion right now, just to eliminate any ambiguity. Further, the board may remember the technical amendments that you acted on just a few months ago. Those amendments include provisions that clarify that ambiguity, so it would specifically say 90 days from the date the board votes to approve the project.
But those amendments have not been
have not yet been adopted,
part of the ordinance.
So we're still in that ambiguous area.
Judy?
I would propose to replace my number 6 as of the conditions with that these conditions be met and the subdivision plat be recorded within 90 days.
Of today's meeting?
Of today. I think we need to make it real clear. Are you willing to stay as of this date or tonight's meeting?
Within 90 days of this meeting? Sure. Or
the last complaint about it was that some felt it was from the day following this meeting.
Okay.
I only feel comfortable if we put that in there. I'm just a 5 years ago when Dick Tinsman was on this board, we went through a long discussion about let's not pass any motions that have any conditions. It just does not make sense. This board has evolved to passing or approving applications with varying lengths of conditions, and it seems recently in the last 2 or 3 years that the number of those have come back to bite us, and we don't seem to come out on the correct side of any of those. I guess I would only feel comfortable if it were read that way.
If it would make the board feel more comfortable, the changes that I proposed to the plan are very minor, and I think that's completely reasonable that those are conditions of approval. They're changing notes. And I thought it was standard practice to allow as a condition of approval an acceptable performance guarantee. The one that other board members may have issue with is my request for a written statement, and if you feel uncomfortable, then someone can make a motion to amend my motion.
I find it reasonable. Although it has been traditionally, there's no reason why not to require a performance guarantee in the form acceptable prior to the vote. Any other discussion?
Mr. Edsel?
Yes.
Could I just comment on the conditions, at least one of them? The ones that go to the plan are, you know, technical, and Brad can make the changes and bring the plan in. Maureen can look at them and see that they were made, and then you can sign the plan at your next meeting as part of your, you know, old business, whatever, without us having to come back. But the requirement that we submit something in writing to justify why we felt we've met conditions that you and your findings have already said we've met strikes me as being a rather subjective condition. In whose eyes are you going to judge what we submit? I've already stated for the record our justification. I don't understand. I mean, I don't understand what I'm supposed to do beyond what I've already done. You've said we've met the condition. There's nothing in the ordinance that says, but the applicant shall submit written materials after the fact to further justify a finding of fact that's already in our favor. So, you know, we have no trouble with the technical changes. Those ought to be made for, so the plan is accurate, and the references to wrong sections should be fixed. But I'm a little surprised that having to submit further justification for meeting a standard which the board, if it accepts this motion, finds we've already met. And then who's going to make the decision as to what I submit is satisfactory? I mean, you could hold us up for 90 days and say we haven't met your standard because you don't like what I submit. So I guess, you know,
I think that's up to whether you...
Well, there's nothing...
I think you're assuming there's going to be an affirmative vote.
Where in the ordinance does it say we have to submit after the fact justification? We've submitted. We've met your standard. Your finding says we've met it. And now you're asking me to give you something else. I mean...
I think we'll just proceed with the vote or any other discussion from the board. Mark, did you have a comment? Any other comments?
I guess I do need to comment. There's a long history regarding the open space, and I don't want to reopen or discuss anything in any detail. It would seem it would be perfectly adequate for me if your written statement, which I understood you placing the justification in the record this evening, was simply put on your letterhead and resubmitted to the board. I think that's a good compromise to what I think is sort of a loggerhead here that I would like to see us get by as quickly as possible.
Could I ask then that the condition be amended, that Ms. Leibner amend her motion to provide that the applicant shall submit, or counsel for the applicant shall submit a letter stating in writing what was stated for the record at tonight's meeting with respect to that section. And I'll go back and watch the tape and put it in writing. So there's no confusion as to what it is you want me to say.
I don't really feel the need to change that. I would find, as Mr. Emery said, that an acceptable piece of writing for the record. But I think how I've proposed it is not particularly onerous.
I'd agree with that. Mark?
I would like to agree with that also. And just coming from the perspective of coming in on this application as a new board member and sitting down to read paragraph Q, the last sentence of which seems to preclude the use of primary scenic areas if there is no access to said areas, I'd like to see some kind of an explanation of how that transpired, that this chunk of land has been set aside to meet the open space criteria of the zoning ordinance, of the subdivision ordinance, but yet at the same time does not address that last sentence. I mean, not that I would push for public access to it either, but if there's something that has been done within this subdivision plan that addresses that, I'd like to see it.
Mr. Wilcox, if you have the time to go through the record on this, you'll see much argument, much legal basis for our conclusion that the board is it is unconstitutional.
Rick, at this point,
Mr. Stetzel, please.
No.
Mr. Wilcox has asked a question. I think you have the right to respond to
He did not ask a question.
This.
He made a comment.
Well, he has not been part of the full deliberation, and
he
I would
not,
like to at
I did
least
not recognize
make my
that.
Point.
One of the problems, Mr. Cheney, to be perfectly honest, is you're long-winded. And if you have something quick to say and you can and make a quick point of it, please go ahead. If you can do that in 60 seconds.
I can do it in 10. We believe that the requirement that public access be given is unconstitutional and supported by many decisions by the United States Supreme Court. That's our position on that.
Thank you. Any further discussion by the board? Stephen?
The statement of justification the board seems to want to have, is this something that you're going to have to approve, or is it just something that's going to be better as a matter of record with no approval necessary?
I think, and Judy, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the motion or the condition was to simply enter it as written record.
That was my intention.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion as read and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Passes as amended.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your patience.
Moving on to new business, the Cranbrook subdivision amendment, a request by Margaret Janess for an amendment to previously approved Cranbrook subdivision located off Mitchell Road, which decreases the size of Lot 35, reference Section 16-2-5. If the applicant or a representative of the applicant could approach the podium and introduce yourself and provide us with just a brief summary of your request.
Good evening. I'm John Roberts, and I'm here with Mrs. Janess tonight. And we would like to get the board's approval to move the line that is currently, Mrs. Janess owns Lot 35 in the Cranbrook subdivision, and she also owns a piece of land alongside of lot, adjacent to Lot 35. On the plan, we're talking about moving the line, this line, which is currently in this position, which we marked on our drawing, to this position, which would give her more room for her parking area, and I believe there's a space there that she likes to play croquet that she would like to keep with her house, if that's possible. So we've prepared two plans for the board to look at, one which is the boundary lines before we have done the proposed line adjustment, and the second is this plan which we would like you ultimately to approve, which shows the lines after the line has been adjusted to encompass this area.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I guess as far as the board proceeding, I'll read right from the notes. Number one, we do not need to deem actually declare completeness of the issue. Public hearing is an issue that is up for debate on the by the board, but it is not required. And we can either begin by requesting additional information, or we can combine that into the question and questions and comments by the board. Any comments? Go ahead, Judy.
I have no comments on this application. It seems very straightforward, but I had a question for Maureen. If under our proposed revisions to the zoning and subdivision ordinance, whether this would be considered a de minimis change?
I would consider this a de minimis change.
As I see no reason for us to even look at it personally.
Under the proposed zoning and subdivision ordinance revisions, the applicant and I would work on this, and there, instead of the submission of 14 plans and going out to all the staff, I would look at it. If I thought it was a de minimis change, would we get just enough plans for the board to see it, and it would be on a consent agenda item, so you wouldn't even have to make the presentation.
Thank you.
Tom?
I just have a question for Mr. Roberts, and this is, it's always a question I have whenever I look at a subdivision lot line. Is there any reason you haven't just simply struck a straight line from the intersection of the driveway in front of the house over to the proposed corner? There are one, two, three line segments there. You come down the center line of the drive and then over with two line segments and then a fourth.
Well, I guess I can't answer that because this change was done some time ago, long before I came to work for land use consultants, and has existed, correct me if I'm wrong, Mrs. Janess, but has existed for some time. And we set the irons there some time ago. The monumentation's been in place for many years. It's just that it was never
recorded.
Never followed through. It's a good question. If I were redoing it, I probably would take at least one angle point out of there. But I believe that there are parts of the topography there that don't show on this plan, perhaps bushes.
There may be a ledge out.
Yeah, there was something there that dictated that the line be placed in that configuration. In essence, I don't know.
The same lines jumped right out at me. There must be something there that
to work around.
Was there a side yard or rear yard side yard setback used from the former barn location when the line was originally surveyed?
I believe there was. I think there was. The other thing I remember about this is the line behind the barn here. I believe there's isn't there a rock wall along here part of the way?
Stone wall. Yeah.
Right. Which Mr. Jeunesse has used as her boundary, or kind of as part of her yard for a number of years. And this line adjustment allows any future conveyances to establish that as her line between this and line 35.
I guess I'd like to congratulate you for showing very clearly what sometimes is a confusing situation, what the existing situation is and what the proposal is. It's very easy to read and very clear.
Thank you. I had good coaching from your planner.
Any other questions, comments?
Motion for the board to consider be in order that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Mrs. Margaret Jeunesse for an amendment to the plans of subdivision lot 35 located on Bellfield Road be approved.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? I have just one question, but I never stop a board member when they're ready to make a motion, so I didn't interrupt you. On lot 35 of Cranbrook, it doesn't show any building envelope, but in the plan of Cranbrook, is there any building window or setbacks
no.
required by the plan?
No.
That'd be the only thing that if that new line interrupted an existing building window.
No, if there was we did the original plan for Cranbrook way back when, which this was part of. I don't believe that there were any setback lines shown on the plan. Generally, I put them on the plan if they're present. If they're not, then we just simply rely on current zoning and setback.
One last question, dealing with this small piece from Ann Esbyer to Ms. Jeunesse. In the first, it's not dotted line outline. And
I,
in the second
I saw
one,
that.
Is there any significance to that? Is it planned to be an outpiece or?
No, I was simply inventorying the pieces that she had acquired through
I
the
see.
Years.
Okay. No other questions? Any other questions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Thank you for taking the time.
Thank you.
Of course. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We don't get that comment very often, but we certainly do.
You usually want to say that first.
do you want to sign?
We're going to record that and play it over and over and over.
Would you like to sign the plan tonight, or do you need to? Or?
Sure.
Okay.
If you just leave it. Okay, under other business, there were three things that I wanted to cover under other business. Number one, I had been requested that we meet with the Zoning Board of Appeals. Larry Clough had called me. Actually, I haven't yet to talk to him, but I'm talking with Maureen. Is the 30th of this month, I believe it's another Tuesday night, is that right? This one?
The last Tuesday.
Last Tuesday? I thought you said it was next Tuesday. Oh, don't scare me. If we're available to have a joint meeting with the Zoning Board of Appeals, they wish to go over. What do they want to go over? Maureen, can you take this?
Following the adoption of the new wetland revisions, which the council adopted last Monday, November 8th, the Zoning Board chairs requested that there be a workshop to get all the board members up to speed on the new changes, and he was hoping that there could be a joint planning board, zoning board workshop where you could all get educated at the same time.
Great idea.
And we discussed the 30th because it's a Tuesday, and it seems if both boards are used to meeting on Tuesdays, that might be easier. The other option would be to move deeper into December.
I think it's best to stay away from the holidays.
Yeah.
As far as 30th at 7 o'clock.
Fine.
Can we try to meet at the community house again?
Sure.
I like the cheery fire in the fireplace. And
I've already scheduled December's workshop over there.
Okay, thank you.
No fire and fireplace.
You can bring one of those little, you know, the little light bulbs in the fake logs. Secondly, Mr. DiMaglia.
Yes, Tom. Are we on the record right
now? Yes, we are.
Okay.
We're out of business. Save that thought.
Okay.
A question just to put out a consensus to the...
It was getting a little giddy. I just wanted to make sure.
Yes, we're still on the record. Beals Ice Cream, the site plan review. We have been in the process of carrying forward. Just open for any consensus to the board whether we continue to leave it open. I'm not sure that there's a strong reason why that has not come back to the planning board. Any feeling from the board?
No, I'll take the applicant at his word and just trust that he won't accuse the board of delaying the process.
Okay.
I don't have any concerns right now.
Okay, good. Lastly, dealing with the decision and the note from the town manager, I just wanted to speak briefly to the issue of the, not really go into the decision or the order by the judge for remand. It seemed to fly in the face of the intent of what was understood at the time of the planning board when that ordinance was reviewed and changed, that the intent was to include not just the road in the subdivision, but from where the dead end starts. That was concurred with the town council. I guess I'll yield to the planner if you can give us some sense of how we can proceed. I think it's important that we do get that issue changed or at least resolved. Is it just a case of taking up another technical amendment and trying to rewrite that or redraft? Or does it go to the ordinance committee first?
At this time, that has been formally forwarded to the ordinance committee. Because it would be an amendment to the subdivision, it doesn't have to, depending on when it goes, the technical amendments are changing our procedures and actually writing procedures that we've kind of been winging in on some of these things. But right now, it's been formally sent to the ordinance committee. The planning board has been asked to comment on it. I know the ordinance committee has talked about putting it on its agenda the next time they meet, which they expect to be in January.
It does say they would appreciate any suggestions the board may have. When do we get that opportunity? Would it be at the meeting of the ordinance committee?
I would recommend that if the board has suggestions that they forward them to the ordinance committee as soon as possible in some kind of written form.
Okay. Is the ordinance committee meeting open for attendance by planning board members?
Yes. Okay. Ordinance committee meetings are open to members of the public, and certainly planning board can attend them and has in the past.
Okay. Do you know when, if you could just notify planning board, and I'm sure about specifically myself, I'd be interested. Any other board members wish to make, I'd just say if you have any input to make to that, those changes, put it in writing and submit it to Maureen. Any other business to come before the board?
Just one other thought. I guess I was surprised to read the letter regarding the Wild Rose subdivision, and considering the land basting that we took at our invitation at the last meeting, and many people continue to be concerned about the complexity of this process. I think the letter that we received regarding the sale of the property only further reinforces the notion that nothing is ever the way it seems, that the variables and possibilities that exist when applicants come before us are very many, and that we therefore have to use a very strict and formal process in order to review the applications, and that tends to be lengthier than I think most of us would like, but one never knows what is going on outside this proceeding.
And I would urge this board perhaps to evolve one more time toward being less accepting of conditions to approvals. And I referenced 5 years ago when the mood was if they can't get it right, they'll come back the following month, but with a strong hand at saying we also won't this board won't change our mind again when they come back. When they're told exactly what this board requires, and those changes are made, they simply were asked to come back one more month. Because echoing the problems that evolve from the feedback that we constantly get, and as you say, Tom, we never know what really is going on out there. This board might do well to consider limiting the number of conditions that we actually place on approvals. Any other comment? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is it seconded? All those in favor? Meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.